We're in Mammoth Cave National Park, and this is the longest known cave in the world with 400 miles mapped thus far. Mammoth Cave is one cave system in a much larger region, which is known throughout the world for having extensive cave systems. Mammoth Cave's visitors come here to see its extensive caverns, cultural artifacts, and interesting formations. Visitors may be unaware that all around them can be found fascinating cave-adapted organisms such as cave crickets, bats, and unique aquatic organisms living in cave rivers and streams. Scientists have documented over 130 species of organisms that use the cave. Some are visitors, however others spend their entire lives inside the cave. Our mission at the Cumberland Piedmont Network is to monitor selected groups of organisms over time and to determine how their populations are doing. Most cave organisms are secretive and difficult to find. There is actually a lot we still don't know about some of these species. The question is, how do we monitor the conditions of these hidden communities? Well, we have to seek them out in their habitat. We have to go snorkeling in the cave river. We have to visit bats at their roosts.
Bats can live in a variety of habitats, but caves make ideal places for them to live. They provide cover from predators, as well as fairly stable temperatures. So in our network, we have 8 or 9 species of bats that use caves at least some time of the year, including the impressive-looking raffinesse big-eared bat. We also have endangered species like the Indiana bat and the gray bat. So we've figured out a variety of scientific approaches or methods in order to monitor the bats on our parks. During the wintertime, when there are no insects available for bats to eat, and bats hibernate, we call that a hibernaculum. And caves make ideal places for them to do that. In order for us to count bats during the winter, we enter the hibernaculum, we find the bats, we count them, and the larger groups, we take photographs of them that we can count later back at the office. In order to minimize how much we disturb the bats, we want to do it very quickly, and we only do the monitoring every other year. During the summer, when bats are active, we use a more high-tech approach to count them. It involves the use of night vision video cameras, thermal infrared cameras, night vision goggles. So the cave behind me is an excellent example of a cave that's used by bats during the summer. Towards dusk, they'll fly out to go eat insects. They might return several times during the night. We use a night vision goggle and a clicker to count the bats as they exit and sometimes enter the cave. Back at the office, we download the video files from the cameras, analyze them, and use them in our data models to get the most accurate count that we can. In recent years, bats in our network that hibernate in caves have been devastated by a serious, deadly disease called white-nose syndrome. It has devastated bat populations and brought many species to the brink of extinction. Population counts that we are doing with our monitoring, we can get a sense of the impact that white-nose syndrome is having on our bat populations.
Flowing through these cave systems are rivers and streams in which we can find fascinating organisms. Swimming in these cold cave rivers and looking for these organisms is not for everybody, as you can imagine. First of all, the water is very cold and the water is dark. When I find an organism in the water, I take a quick measurement and shout out the species code to a field assistant.
4 miles.
We can find eyeless fish, eyeless crayfish. There are also lots of tiny crustaceans such as amphipods and isopods. And in the case of Mammoth Cave National Park, a unique creature, the Kentucky cave shrimp, which is a federally listed endangered species. We're mandated to monitor the populations of the Kentucky cave shrimp, but it's not easy to find at all. The cave rivers are big and dark, and the cave shrimp are small and transparent. After spending so much time getting to these remote places, it's a real thrill when you first see one of these creatures.
Well, most people don't think of rats as particularly attractive. The Allegheny wood rat, a native wood rat, have an important part to play in the ecosystem of a cave. In some parts of the country, wood rat populations have declined. That's one of the reasons we decided to monitor them here, as well as the important role that they play providing food or bringing nutrients into the cave ecosystem. They leave at night to go find food. They eat nuts and berries, seeds, leaves, mushrooms. They bring some of that back to their cave, and that food become food for other animals in the cave. Because wood rats are nocturnal, they're secretive, they're not easy to count, we use motion-sensitive cameras to document whether they're present or absent, and they can be tough on the equipment.
It sure looks like we got evidence of a wood rat. The cable has been chewed in half, so it exacted its revenge on us. Let's take a look and see if we have any pictures in here.
This just illustrates how every animal can be a critical part of the web of life in a cave.
Cave crickets are the most numerous organism found throughout the cave system. They are a keystone species. That means they have a lot of other organisms depending on the food that they bring into the cave. Cave crickets are found only within a certain distance of cave entrances. So we place a random series of transects. These transects are projected by lasers onto the ceiling, and we look for clusters of cave crickets within those transects. We then take photographs, and we're able to count the numbers of cave crickets in each cluster and analyze the population data from there. Though we can't always see these creatures, without them, the cave would lose something of its mystery.
Salamander?
Salamander, yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's great.
It's almost like a fish.
Mm-hmm. Cumberland Piedmont Network scientists work with multiple parks to monitor a range of vital signs, including air and water quality, and animal and plant communities. It is our job to provide rigorous, timely data to decision makers so that they can be good stewards of our national parks.